Welcome to the Indo News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the news articles chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page number of different editions. Link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles are given in the description box as well as the comment section for the benefit of the mobile viewers. Now let us take up this news article. See, this news article can be used as case study in your mains answer. You have to use lot of data, information and examples, case studies in your mains answer. Doing such value addition will differentiate your answers from others. It will impress the examiner and it will boost your score. So case studies are very important when it comes to value addition. They are also fun to learn. With this information in mind, let us learn about this case study. See, this case study is about a school teacher at Mullur village in Kodagu district of Karnataka. See, we all know that the spread of coronavirus has closed a lot of educational institutions. So now the students are heavily reliant on online classes to continue their education. This high dependency on online education has caused a lot of problems in rural areas, especially among the tribals and first generation learners. This is because, unlike the urban areas, the students in rural areas do not have adequate facilities. They also don't have the parental backup to ensure the continuity of education. And rural areas also face the problem of weak reception of signals, which is very important for online education. So these are the hurdles faced by the rural areas when it comes to online education. So in order to overcome these hurdles, a school teacher in Karnataka has taken up a lot of efforts. This case study is about that. The name of the teacher is Mr. Sadisha. He is a teacher in Mullur village in Kodagu district of Karnataka. See, this teacher, he thought of keeping the children engaged in learning even during the lockdown. But the connectivity issues at his place made it difficult for him to stay connected with the students. So to overcome this hurdle, he spent 2 months in constructing a makeshift room at the top of a mango tree. This room was located at a height of 20 feet from the ground. He constructed using locally available materials. And this makeshift room at the height of 20 feet from the ground helped him to overcome the problem of weak reception. Since the room was located at the height of 20 feet from the ground, there were no interference and the signal reception was better. This helped the children to continue the online education. Apart from this, this wonderful person also invested in few equipments to further enhance the teaching process. So he took a lot of initiatives to bring education to the rural areas during these tough times. This example can be used as case study in your mains answer. When the question is about digital divide, when the question is about ethical values, attitudinal change, behavioral change, leadership qualities, you can use this example as a case study. It will boost your score, trust me. With this, we have come to the end of this article. This article is a classic example of teacher's tireless dedication and efforts in imparting the best of his knowledge even during the worst times. Now, let us move on to the next article. Now, let us take up this article. This article is about the successful test fire of Agni P missile. So, today, let us focus on the specifications and capabilities of Agni P missiles. And we shall also learn about other class of Agni missiles. This is a highly important topic from prelims perspective. See, in prelims, a lot of science and technology questions are asked from current affairs. And in recent years, importance is given to defense technology, missile technology, and other science and technology topics. So learning about this topic will be highly rewarding from prelims perspective. We have approximately 100 days for prelims, so let us make use of it. The syllabus relevant to this article is displayed on the screen. Aspirants can go through it. First, let us start the discussion by discussing Agni class of missiles. See, Agni class of missiles are the centerpiece of India's nuclear launch capability. So far we had 5 missiles. Now we added another one called Agni P missile. First, let us discuss about the 5 missiles. Agni 1 to Agni 5. See, these missiles are designed and developed by DRDO. This is the important point. These missiles belong to the family of medium to intercontinental range ballistic missiles. The most important aspect is that these missiles can be fired from road and rail mobile launchers. These missiles are also powered by solid propellants. See, the Agni missiles are a product of Integrated Guided Missile Development Project, IGMDP. IGMDP was launched by Ministry of Defense in 1983.
See, we have inducted Agni missiles into services to act as deterrents. It also helps us to meet the country's security requirements. The Agni missiles are part of the credible deterrence by India against China and Pakistan. So Agni series is also at the core of India's deterrence in the larger context of Sino-Indian power equation. Now let us see about each missile in brief. This is very important. First, let us see about Agni 1. See, Agni 1 is a medium range ballistic missile and has a range of 700 to 800 kilometers. It weighs 12 tons. It is 15 meters in length. Agni 1 missile is capable of carrying a conventional payload of 1000 kgs. It can also carry nuclear warhead. Agni 1 missile travels at a speed of 2.5 kilometers per second. Agni 1 missiles are operation with the Strategic Force Command SFC of Indian Army. So these are the important points regarding Agni 1 missile. Now let us move on to Agni 2. See, the second missile in the series is Agni 2. Agni 2 is a surface-to-surface nuclear-capable missile. It is an intermediate-range ballistic missile, IRBM. It is capable to cover the range of 2000 to 2500 km. So, this is an upgradation. The length of the missile is 20 meters. It has a diameter of 1 meter. The weight of the Agni 2 missile is little more than Agni 1. It weighs 18 tons. Agni 2 missile has two stages, and it has solid propellant in both of its stages. Agni 2 missile was among the first weapons to get into the Indian Strategic Force arsenal. So these are the important points regarding Agni 2 missile. Now let us see about Agni 3. See, Agni 3 is also an IRBM, intermediate range ballistic missile. It has a range of 2500 kilometers to 3000 kilometers. It is based upon the powerful solid propellant in its both stages. It can have a warhead of 1.5 tons. See, the Agni 3 missile has been claimed that the missile circular error probable, CEP, lies within 40 meters only. What is CEP? Circular error probable. See, CEP is defined as an imaginary circle taken within the ground target as center, and it provides the missile accuracy. And since Agni 3 has CEP within 40 meters, this makes Agni 3 most accurate and deadliest strategic ballistic missile among the range of missiles in the world. It has also been reported that with smaller payloads, Agni 3 missile can hit strategic targets even beyond 3500 kilometers. So these are the important points regarding Agni 3 missile. Now let us focus on Agni 4. See, Agni 4 missile has a range of 3500 to 4000 km. It was earlier named as Agni 2 Prime. Later, Agni 4 was given as the name of the missile. It can carry a warhead of 1 ton. It is also a two-stage missile. This is the important point. For example, UPSC can give a statement like Agni 4 missile is a three-stage propellant missile. So it is important to study the basic information regarding these missiles. Now coming back to the Agni 4 missile, the length of the missile is 20 meters and the launch weight of the missile is about 17 tons. So these are the important points regarding Agni 4 missile. Now let us see about Agni 5. As the name says, this is the fifth missile in the series. It is an intercontinental surface-to-surface ballistic missile, ICBM. This is a very important point. Agni 5 is India's first ICBM. It has a range of more than 5000 kilometers. So it is a long-range nuclear-capable ballistic missile. This missile is 17.5 meter in length and it weighs around 50 tons. So it is a huge upgradation. It has three propulsion stages. So far we have seen about only two stages. Agni 5 has three propulsion stages. It can carry a warhead weighing more than a ton. Also, Agni 5 missile has a unique advantage. Agni 5 missile uses canister launch missile system or canisterization of missile. What is this canisterization of missile technology? See, canisterization of missile is a technology in which the warheads are pre-mated to the delivery vehicle and they are kept sealed for storage and transport. Aspirants can look at this image for better understanding. This is an Agni 5 missile in the form of canister. So what is the advantage of this canister technology? See, the canister technology, it increases our readiness. Our response time will be very shorter. we can launch the missile in just few minutes. So it provides necessary operational flexibility to the forces. See, India is surrounded by nuclear threats everywhere. We have Pakistan, we have China, we have North Korea. So these are the nuclear countries surrounding us. So increasing our readiness is an important factor. And Agni-5 missiles is a right step in this direction. Another important advantage of canisterization is it enhances missile longevity by protecting the solid fuel from the elements. So it acts as a protection shield. So these are the important points regarding Agni-5 missile. Now let us see the important missile in the news. Agni-P missile. What does P stands for? P stands for Prime. And according to the news, this missile was successfully test fired yesterday. It was fired from Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Island. This island is off the coast of Odisha. In this test fire, the missile met all the mission objectives with high level of accuracy. It was a successful test. See, Agni-P missile is a new generation advanced variant of Agni class of missiles. We can say it is an advanced version of Agni-1 missile. It has been designed and developed by DRDO. It has many advanced technologies. So it will strengthen India's credible deterrence capabilities. Now let us see the important features of Agni-P missile. First important point, it is a nuclear capable ballistic missile. Second one, it is a canisterized missile. We have discussed about advantages of canisterization. Third important feature, the range capability of Agni-P missile is between 1000 to 2000 kilometers. Fourth important point, it is a surface to surface missile that can carry a payload of around 1000 kg. It can also carry a nuclear warhead. Fifth important point, it is a two-stage missile. But the both stages have composite rocket motors. In addition to this, the guidance systems are equipped with electromechanical actuators. This is an important feature. Moving on to the next one. Sixth feature, it is a solid fuel weapon system. It is also guided by state-of-the-art navigation system. Next important feature, it has the flexibility to be fired from both road and rail mobile launches. When we compare it with other Agni missiles, it has complete technology upgrade in every way possible. It has improved parameters, improved maneuvering, improved accuracy. So it is upgradation over all other Agni missiles. See, the most important feature of Agni Prime missile is it is a sleek missile. It weighs less than Agni-1 missile. This is due to the integration of new technologies. So these are the important points regarding Agni Prime missiles. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Agni-1 to Agni-5 missiles and we gave special focus to Agni-P missiles. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now look at this article. This news article discussion is regarding the HIV infection. This article also provides few suggestions to tackle the spread of HIV infections. Now let us see about it. The syllabus relevant to this article is displayed on the screen. Aspirants can go through it. First, let us see about HIV. What is HIV? We all know that HIV stands for Human Immunodeficiency Virus. It is a virus that attacks the body's immune system. Why is this virus so dangerous? People always fear this virus. This is because this virus has no effective cure currently. So once people get HIV, they have to live with it for life. This is the reason why many people are scared of HIV virus. But we have to know that with proper medical care, HIV can be controlled. It is not a fatal disease. See, when we are talking about HIV, we also hear about the term called AIDS. Many people confuse between HIV and AIDS. What is AIDS? AIDS stands for Acquired Immunodeficiency Syndrome. See, if HIV patient is not treated, it leads to a condition called AIDS. So not all HIV patients will have AIDS. AIDS is like the final condition if HIV is not treated. So these are the basic information regarding the HIV virus. Now let us discuss the article. See, according to the article, the COVID-19 outbreak has made HIV infection unnoticed. It has taken the spotlight. The COVID-19 pandemic has taken all the spotlight. See, India took every possible step to fight against HIV or AIDS. For example, India ran a lot of information and education campaigns in 1990s. India also enforced strict antenatal protocols, upgradation of blood banks with superior testing facilities in order to control the spread of HIV. In addition to this, excellent awareness programs and intensive follow-up action plans led to significant decline in HIV incidence in India. But according to the author of the article, all these measures have been successful only till the year 2013. What happened after 2013? According to the author, the careless approach of the government resulted in poor implementation of AIDS control program. So because of this, even before the COVID-19 pandemic, India was not well prepared to tackle HIV. We were struggling. And with the current COVID-19 pandemic, the HIV infection is almost unnoticed by the government. See, the aim of the World Health Organization was to ensure that 90% of the people living with HIV or AIDS are on antiretroviral therapy. Antiretroviral therapy is given to HIV patients to control the infection. So WHO wanted 90% of the HIV patients to be on antiretroviral therapy by the year 2020. But India has pushed this target by at least 5 years. This shows that we are lagging. Similarly, the 2017 National Health Policy and the UN Sustainable Development Goal aim to end AIDS by 2030. But now this goal looks impossible to achieve. With these facts in mind, now let us see where India is slipping in achieving its target. Aspirants can use this data as value addition in their mains answer. See, HIV infection diagnosis rate dropped from 60% in 2010 to 23% in 2019. This is a great drop. So we are not diagnosing many HIV infected patients. Only with proper diagnosis, we can give the proper treatment and we can control the spread of infection. This drop in diagnosis also happened at the time when the mortality rate doubled and the new cases of HIV infection spiked 5 times more. So we can see that the infection is increasing, but the diagnosis is dropping. This is a dangerous combination. Also, according to the National AIDS Control Organization's annual HIV estimates report of 2019, there were over 58,000 AIDS-related deaths and over 69,000 new HIV infection added to the pool of 2.3 million people living with HIV or AIDS. So the findings of the report also supports the observations of the author. Why this crisis happened in India? This happened because the campaign to educate and empower the vulnerable communities was losing steam. So what can be the solution to address these problems? The author of the article list number of suggestions in this article. Let us see them one by one. First suggestion, strong political leadership, financial support, public support and activism are essential in the successful handling of the movement. For this, India needs to keep on debating HIV issue. It must be in the spotlight. In addition to this, India must focus on broad coalition of economists, scientists, doctors, researchers, technicians, civil society representatives, and policymakers. To put it in simple words, a multi-sectoral and multi-pronged strategy is essential to control the HIV spread. This is the first suggestion given by the author of the article. Now let us move on to the second suggestion. Second suggestion is we have to trust the formula and support science-driven responses. In addition to that, we should also have good quality data, research findings, and consolidating guidelines which will help us in fighting HIV infection. This is the second suggestion given by the author. Moving on to the third one. Third solution. We have to repurpose the roadmap for reducing the new HIV infections by 2030. To put it in simple words, we have to bring in few changes to the strategic plans that are currently in operation. This helps in flexibility and adapt to the changing socio-economic environment, especially after the COVID-19 pandemic. This is the third suggestion given by the author. Now let us move on to the fourth suggestion. See, the core of every exit strategy is a strong surveillance system. The nationalized AIDS treatment plan is a perfect example of early detection, diagnosis and treatment saved many lives. So in order to strengthen the approach, the government should make use of integrated counseling and testing centers in early detection of infections. This is the fourth suggestion given by the author. Now let us move on to the final suggestion. According to the author, the government should re-energize these centers along with the 32,000 plus primary and urban health centers. Why should we re-energize these centers? According to the author, by doing so, we will uphold the right to treatment and dignity of individuals affected by disease such as AIDS and other pandemics. So these are the few suggestions given by the author to tackle the spread of HIV infection. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about HIV virus in brief. We saw the current status of India when it comes to tackling of HIV infection. And we also saw the solutions to overcome the present hurdles. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this article. According to this article, Ukraine and the United States have launched joint naval exercises in the Black Sea. So this is the gist of this article. See, recently on 25th June, we have discussed about Black Sea in detail. So interested aspirants can go through that video to learn about basic information regarding Black Sea. Today, let us discuss in detail some other important seas in the region. This will help you in prelims. See, in prelims, a lot of questions are asked from map, and most of the map questions are from current affairs. So make sure you have basic information regarding the places which are presented in current affairs. It will help you boost your score. The syllabus for reference is displayed on the screen. Aspirants can go through it. Now let us discuss in detail about some important seas in that region. First, let us see about Red Sea. See, Red Sea is a narrow strip of water. It extends southeastward from Suez, Egypt. It extends for nearly 1930 kilometers. It extends up to a strait called Bab el Mandeb. Have a look at this map. You'll have a better understanding. You can see it. Red Sea is a narrow strip of water. It extends southeastward from Suez, Egypt. It extends up to a strait called Bab el Mandeb. When you look at this map, you can see the north end of Red Sea splits into two parts. It splits into Gulf of Suez to the northwest, and it splits into Gulf of Aqaba to the northeast. Another important information an aspirant must know is the countries surrounding Red Sea. Usually these kind of questions are asked in UPSC. They'll give a statement like Egypt is surrounding Red Sea. Assess the statement, which of the above statements are correct. So we have to know what are the countries which surrounds the Red Sea. Egypt, Sudan, Eritrea lies to the west of Red Sea, whereas Saudi Arabia and Yemen lies to the east of Red Sea. I would say that this point is very important. You can expect a statement from these kind of information. See, when we are talking about Red Sea, it is one of the world's hottest and saltiest seawater. And we also know that it is one of the most heavily traveled waterways in the world. But many of us don't know why it is called Red Sea. That is an interesting information. See, normally the Red Sea has a blue-green color tone, but occasionally it becomes red in color due to extensive bloom of algae. That is the reason why it got its name Red Sea. The name of the algae is Trichodesmium erythrarium. This is an interesting point. Because of this algae, the water body turns into reddish brown color, and because of this change in color, it was given the name Red Sea. So far we have discussed about Red Sea. Now let us see about another important sea called Mediterranean Sea. See, Mediterranean Sea is an intercontinental sea. It lies between various continents like Asia, Africa and Europe. So because of this reason, it is also called the incubator of Western civilization. Many Western civilization thrived because of Mediterranean Sea. It is almost 4000 km west to east. Now look at this map. We can see that the Mediterranean Sea extends from Strait of Gibraltar from the west to the Gulf of Iskenderun in the east. We can see that the Gulf of Iskenderun is on the southwestern coast of Turkey. Just go through this map for better understanding. The Mediterranean Sea is connected with the Atlantic Ocean by the Strait of Gibraltar. This is an important point. It is also connected to Black Sea through Strait of Dardanelles, Sea of Marmara and the Strait of Bosporus. So we can see that Mediterranean Sea is also connected to Atlantic Ocean as well as Black Sea. Another very important point, Mediterranean Sea is connected with the Red Sea by the Suez Canal. This is very important point. Suez Canal is often presented in news. So make sure you make note of this point. Mediterranean Sea is connected with the Red Sea by the Suez Canal. You can observe this in the map. There lies the Mediterranean Sea. In the southeast corner of the map, you can see the Gulf of Suez. And you can see the Suez Canal connecting Mediterranean Sea and the Red Sea. So these are the important points regarding Mediterranean Sea. Now let us discuss about another sea called Aegean Sea. This is not as important as Red Sea or Mediterranean Sea. So let us see about Aegean Sea in brief. See, Aegean Sea is an arm of Mediterranean Sea. So it is located between Greek Peninsula on the west and Asia Minor on the east. Have a look at this map for better understanding. We can see that Aegean Sea is between the Greek Peninsula on the west and Asia Minor in the east. To the south of the Aegean Sea lies the Crete Island. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Red Sea, we saw about Mediterranean Sea, and we saw about Aegean Sea in brief. Red Sea and Mediterranean Sea are very important from prelims perspective. Aegean Sea is not that important. Just go through it in brief. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this article. It is a data point. See, data points are essential from the perspective of value addition. Data points give you a lot of data and statistics. You can include this data and statistics in your answer as value addition. It will differentiate your answer, you will impress the examiner, and it will boost your score. So with this information in mind, let us discuss this data point article. In this news article, we shall be discussing the impacts of COVID-19 pandemic, especially on personal income and food consumption. There are three segments in this topic discussion. Now let us take up the first one. The first one is about income drop. See, according to the Hunger Watch report, by the month of October 2020, 27% of its respondents lost their income due to national lockdown. Also, according to this report, nearly 24% of its respondents lost 50% of their income by October 2020. The loss of income is compared to the pre-lockdown level income. It is important to note that only 6% responded that the income did not change despite the lockdown. So most of the citizens of India are affected by lockdown. They have lost their income. This is the important observation from this data point. Now let us move on to the next segment. The next segment is related to retail inflation. See, recently, the prices of edible oil and pulses are increasing significantly. This article highlights the retail price analysis of 21 essential items across India. According to the analysis, it found that if a consumer has to buy a kilogram of essential item in the month of June 2021, he or she has to spend ₹500 more compared to the average cost between year 2016 and 2019. So in order to buy an essential item, a consumer has to spend ₹500 more in the month of June 2021. This is a great strain on consumer. Now look at this table. This table is given for your reference. This table indicates the retail price difference in various occasions. Aspirants can have a glance at it. They can use some of this data as value addition in their answer. See, the high retail inflation along with the drop in income level has burdened the consumers. This is the important observation from the discussion of first two segments. Now let us move on to the third segment of data point. In the third segment, the impact of both these factors can be seen from the change in consumption level. To put it in simple words, the effect of retail inflation and drop in income level has affected the consumption level of consumers. Have a look at this table. This table displays the data of October 2020. It is compared with March 2020. From this table, we can see that the level of household consumption of all commodities listed have decreased. For example, nearly 38% of households reported that the consumption of vegetables decreased a lot in October 2020. In addition to this, the consumption of egg and meat commodities have also decreased. This will affect the nutritional security of a country. So these are the important data given in the article. Aspirants can make note of it. You can use it as value addition in your answers. So in conclusion, we can say that adequate policy responses are the need of the hour to address both food and nutrition security in the country. So that is the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about data regarding income drop. We saw data regarding retail inflation. And we saw data regarding consumption level. Use it aptly in your mains answers. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now look at this article. See, as we know, Jammu Air Base has come under drone attack recently. We have been constantly hearing this news for the past few days. This drone attack has led to detention of at least three terror suspects by the J&K police. Now coming to the article. See, according to the article, the National Security Guard, NSG, and the National Investigation Agency, NIA, did not find any debris of drones from the two blast spots. So now the agencies are investigating the possibility of the usage of long-distance launching pad to send drones. So now these agencies are investigating the possibility of the use of a long distance launching pad to send drones. This is what which is given in this article. This news is not that important to us, but the agency National Security Guard and National Investigation Agency are important. So in this context, let us discuss in brief about NIA and NSG. First, let us see about NIA. See, the National Investigation Agency was set up under the act called NIA Act. It was enacted in 2008. This NIA Act extends to the whole of India. It applies to citizens of India even if they are outside India. So this act is very powerful. It also applies to person in the service of government wherever they may be present in the world. So if an Indian citizen is present anywhere in the world, NIA Act still applies to him or her. The NIA Act is also applicable to persons on ships and aircrafts registered in India wherever they may be present in the world. So this act is really powerful. And the National Investigation Agency was created by this act. See, the National Investigation Agency at present is functioning as the Central Counter-Terrorism Law Enforcement Agency in India. The National Investigation Agency can investigate and prosecute for offences under the acts specified in the given schedule. The schedule is displayed on the screen and the acts are listed below. Interested aspirants can go through it. So the NIA can investigate and prosecute for offences under these displayed acts. See, when we are talking about NIA, the superintendence of the agency is vested in the central government. So the central government has control over NIA. But the state government may request the central government to hand over the investigation of a case to the NIA. Also, the center has the authority to issue directions to NIA to take over the investigation of a case. So central government has the ultimate control over NIA. State governments can only place requests. So these are the important points regarding NIA. Now let us discuss about NSG. What is NSG? NSG stands for National Security Guard. See, in the year 1984, the Union Cabinet decided to create a federal contingency force. They wanted this force to comprise of highly motivated, well-trained and specially equipped personnel to tackle terrorism. So in order to give vision to these objectives, National Security Guard was created. The National Security Guard was formally created in 1986. It was created by an act called NSG Act 1986. What is the basic philosophy of NSG? See, the basic philosophy of NSG is swift and speedy strike and immediate withdrawal from the theater of action. See, NSG is a unique force. It was modeled on the pattern of Special Air Service SAS of the UK, and it was also modeled on the pattern of GSG-9 of Germany. This is an important feature of NSG. See, the NSG has two complementary elements. They are the Special Action Group SAG, comprising Army personnel. Another one is Special Ranger Group SRG, comprising personnel drawn from Central Armed Police Force or State Police Force. So these are the two complementary elements of NSG. So that is the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about NIA and NSG. They are important from prelims perspective. I have a basic understanding of them so that you can eliminate the options. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this article. See, according to the article, the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, ICAI, has urged the Supreme Court for allowing it to conduct Chartered Accountants exam. The Chartered Accountants exam is scheduled next month. ICAI argued that CA exams are professional examinations and it is not similar to school exams. It also stated that opt-out option was available for candidates if the candidate or anyone in their family tested positive for COVID-19. So it has requested the Supreme Court for allowing it to conduct the exams. In this context, let us learn about ICAI, Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. The first important point is it is a statutory body. It was set up in 1949. It was established by the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. So it was established even before the adoption of Constitution. See, ICAI is a premier accounting body. It was established for regulating the profession of chartered accountancy in India. It functions under the administrative control of Ministry of Corporate Affairs. This is very important point. UPSC is interested in ministry type questions. So make note of this point. ICAA is under the administrative control of Ministry of Corporate Affairs. It is also important to note that ICAA is the second largest professional body of chartered accountants in the world. The affairs of the ICAA are managed in accordance with the provisions of 1949 Act and Chartered Accountants Regulation of 1988. The affairs of ICAA are managed by a council. This council is empowered to frame regulations under the Act and to constitute necessary standing and non-standing committees. The Council of ICAA consists of 40 members. Among the 40 members, 32 are elected by the Chartered Accountants and remaining 8 are nominated by the Central Government. The 8 nominees by the Central Government represent the Comptroller and Auditor General of India, Securities and Exchange Board of India, SEBI, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, Ministry of Finance and other stakeholders. See, ICAA is also known for maintaining highest standard in technical ethical areas and for sustaining stringent examination and education standards. Now let us see its role. ICAA regulates the profession of accountancy. It is responsible for the education and examination of chartered accountancy course, along with continuing the professional education of members. It also formulates accounting standards and prescribed standard auditing procedures. It also exercises disciplinary jurisdiction. The functions of ICAA are threefold: education functions, regulatory functions, and disciplinary functions. It also formulates a code of ethics to be followed by the members. So these are the important role of ICAA. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. Now let us move on to the final article. See, the final article is about sedition. We have discussed about sedition in detail in our May 22nd daily news analysis. So interested aspirants can go through it for revision. Now let us move on to the practice prelims question. First practice prelims question. Which of the following statements are correct with reference to Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, ICAA? First statement. It is a statutory body established before independence. Second statement. It is headed by the President of India. Third statement, it formulates accounting standards and prescribes standard auditing procedures. Select the correct answer using the code given below. A1 only, B1 and 3 only, C3 only, D2 and 3 only. Now let us take the first statement. See, the first statement is incorrect. ICAA was established by the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. So it was established in 1949. It was not established before independence. So this statement is incorrect. Now let us move on to the second statement. It is headed by the President of India. This statement is also incorrect. See, we have discussed in the article. The affairs of ICAA are managed by a council. The council consists of 40 members. 32 members are elected by the Chartered Accountants. 8 members are nominated by the Central Government. ICAA is not headed by the President of India. So second statement is incorrect. Moving on to the third statement. Third statement is correct. ICAA formulates accounting standards and prescribes standard auditing procedures. So only the third statement is correct. First and second are incorrect. The answer is option C, 3 only. Now let us move on to the second question. The second question is from the Agni P missile article. Consider the following statement with reference to Agni P missile. First statement. It is a nuclear capable ballistic missile with a range capability between 1000 and 2000 kilometers. Second statement. It is developed under the Integrated Guided Missile Development Project, IGMDP. Third statement. It is the first canisterized missile in Agni series. Which of the statements given above are correct? A1 and 2 only, B3 only, C2 only, D1 only. Now let us take up the first statement. The first statement is correct. From the discussion of the article, we know that Agni P missile is a nuclear capable ballistic missile with a range capability between 1000 and 2000 kilometers. So this statement is correct. Now let us move on to the second statement. Before discussing the second statement, let us see about Integrated Guided Missile Development Project in brief, IGMDP. See, IGMDP was launched by the Ministry of Defense in 1983. It was a brainchild of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. The agencies which were responsible for the development of IGMDP are DRDO and Ordnance Factories. The purpose of IGMDP is to develop strategic missiles into various categories. The purpose of IGMDP was to create a family of strategic and tactical guided missiles. In the category of strategic missiles, it created Prithvi and Agni. Agni 1 to 5 is under IGMDP. Under tactical guided missile category, IGMDP created Akash, Trishul and Nag. It is important to note that IGMDP program was terminated in the year 2008. In 2008, the objectives of IGMDP were achieved, so it was terminated. So the Agni P missile, which was recently test fired, it was not developed under the Integrated Guided Missile Development Project. So second statement is incorrect. IGMDP was terminated in the year 2008. Now moving on to the third statement. It is the first canisterized missile in Agni series. This statement is wrong. From the discussion of the article, we know that Agni 5 missile was already canisterized. Agni 5 was the predecessor to Agni P missile. It was already canisterized. So third statement is incorrect. So the first statement is correct. Second statement is incorrect. Third statement is also incorrect. The correct answer is option D, one only. Now let us move on to the third question. Which of the following countries share border with the Red Sea? 1. Sudan, 2. Saudi Arabia, 3. Israel, 4. Yemen, 5. Tunisia. Select the correct answer using the code given below. A. 1, 2 and 3 only. B. 2, 3 and 4 only. C. 1, 2 and 4 only. D. 1, 2, 4 and 5 only. See, we know that these kind of questions are important. Map questions are regularly asked in prelims. So whenever you are studying places, approach the news from this perspective. Now look at this map. It is clear that Israel and Tunisia do not share border with the Red Sea. So the answer is C, 1, 2 and 4 only. Sudan, Saudi Arabia and Yemen share border with Red Sea. Sudan lies to the west of the Red Sea. Saudi Arabia and Yemen lies to the east of the Red Sea. You can observe this from the map. Mains practice questions are displayed here. You can write your answer and post in the comment section below. With this, we have come to the end of the news analysis. If you like the video, click like, comment and subscribe. Thank you.